This podcast is a member of the Red 5 Network. For more Red 5 Network podcasts and content creators, visit bio.link/red5.
Good Lord, didn't anybody here subscribe?
Hello?
Hi, this is Sean from Extra Star Wars.
Oh.
And you're listening to the Scarif Scuttlebutt.
It's time for the Jedi to end.
Okay, folks, thanks for joining me on episode 181 of the Scarif Scuttlebutt podcast. Last week, we had a good time with Dave from What Star Wars Means to You. And that was our first show of the year, 2024. Are people still saying Happy New Year? That's okay. Happy New Year to everybody. And thanks for discovering us. If this is going to be your first time listening to the podcast, if not, welcome back. And I just wanted to say pigs are flying. Hell has frozen over. If you have listened to the show since Brad and I started back in 2019, you guys know that we're not too fond of the sequel trilogy, one movie in particular, but we're going to talk about the sequel trilogy tonight. And the impetus for that, one of our friends, Semper Fi Dani, had posted something having to do with The Last Jedi, and she challenged me to talk about the sequel trilogy and maybe a little Last Jedi discussion, but this should be a lot of fun. I'd like to say hello there to Semper Fi Dani. How's it going tonight?
Hey, it's going well.
Excellent, excellent. Tell me a little bit, real fast, before we start the big discussion, tell me a little bit about your Star Wars story. How did you get into the fandom?
Okay, sure. I'm actually, it's kind of an interesting story because I was born literally the day after Star Wars, the original Star Wars, came out. So Star Wars has always sort of been on the periphery of my life, but I've never actually watched Star Wars up until after The Last Jedi came out, but before Solo. So that's when I sort of came into the fandom. And I mean, I kind of grew up in a single parent household with a sister. So it was always kind of perceived as like Star Wars was the boy thing, you know, like, you know, I don't know if it necessarily had an appeal for me specifically, but it was hard to sort of ignore Star Wars in general. I mean, I had aunts and uncles. I watched the Ewoks cartoon, so I had a little bit of exposure as a kid. You know, in the 90s, my friends went to the Phantom Menace, and I got to hear all the discourse about that at the time. I had friends that worked at BioWare and made Knights of the Old Republic, so I kind of got to see a little behind the scenes on that. And so it was always kind of just there. And then fast forward to, I can't remember what year that was. It's been so long. I had just, you know, I had just finished sort of unsuccessfully. My husband and I were trying to have a child, and we went through the fertility route, and that didn't work out for us. And so I was kind of in a little, we had kind of settled on not having children. I was a little depressed. And on Easter in Canada, we have this channel called Showcase, and they show Star Wars marathons. And I just happened to stumble in, and I started watching. And the first movie I saw was The Force Awakens. And the minute that we got to the scene where Rey is sitting in front of the AT-AT or AT-AT or whatever you want to call it, and that sense of isolation and that sense of barrenness, you know, in the barren desert, that loneliness, it just clicked on me, and I became a fan ever since. And I love the thing. And then afterwards, I started off with that. And then my husband's like, well, if you like this, let's watch The New Hope. And so we watched A New Hope, and then Empire, then Return of the Jedi. And then we went back to the prequel trilogies, and my husband had braced me that it's like, he didn't really care for them. And yet I love them. And he, in the 90s, he actually found that they were better this time around, because at that point I'd become this stupid super fan and all my friends knew it. And I had a friend that had access to advanced tickets to see the opening night of Solo. So that was my first Star Wars movie. I just kind of moseyed on towards the Rise of Skywalker with the rest of you.
Wow, that's interesting. You know, I always say that Star Wars catches you at weird times in your life, no matter how old you are. It's, you know, for me, it was, you know, I was 8 years old in 1977. And when that Star Destroyer went overhead, I lost my mind. My little 8 year old Ro was flabbergasted. And I think, you know, from an emotional standpoint, I think, you know, a lot of people talk about fandom in general, but I think Star Wars, you know, it's not the only IP or fandom that does this, but it really clicks deep and emotional for some people, for a lot of people. And I think that is why the fandom is so emotional. I think we have a sense of ownership to the franchise. And I know, you know, sometimes when people don't draw that line between, you know, the reality of it and the passion, I guess, that's when you start getting a little, I don't know, weirdly obsessive about stuff like that. And we'll get into that in a second. But
well, I think too, if I just want to say, I think what makes Star Wars stand apart is that emotional connection. I mean, it's no shortage of franchise out there, but you don't see, I mean, the only thing I can see that comes relatively close maybe is the Bond franchise, the James Bond stuff. And even then, I'm not quite sure it hits the same way. So,
right. I mean, Star Trek is similar. I mean, there's, you know, there's okay, kind of a little bit of a crossover between Star Trek and Star Wars.
A little bit, yeah.
You know, it's, you know.
But it's not like with all the franchises in there, it's not a lot that catch the emotional hook.
Yeah, absolutely. I think, you know, I always say I've got this saying that if you cut me, I bleed Star Wars. So it's definitely, you know, it's definitely a franchise that. That plays on your emotions in so many different ways. And obviously because we're still talking about it decades later, there are still people talking about, you know, one aspect of Star Wars or another, whether it's characters or behind the scenes. I mean, it's just, you know, it's an interesting discussion, no matter how you slice it. And I think that is what makes Star Wars kind of timeless and special for a lot of people. And that also depends on, I guess, you know, how you relate to that one X factor that brought you into the fandom. But, you know, you said it earlier, it's the emotional connection that we make. Like I said, whether it's the characters or the process or the situations, whatever it is that we are dealing with in life at that moment, is what I guess connects us with the franchise. And I think that's pretty cool. I think I don't think any other medium in entertainment does that. I mean, I think music does that because we feel a connection to music, you know, but you know, movies really work on your psyche in every way. You've got the visual, you've got the sound, you've got the emotion, because obviously when you see a movie, you know, the film really works on you in all sorts of ways. I think that's pretty cool.
Absolutely. And I don't disagree with that at all.
Han Solo, I've been waiting for this day for a long time.
I wanted to, I have in the notes, because I wanted to discuss the hype that surrounded The Force Awakens. And I know you had answered me regarding, I guess, your trajectory into the fandom is a little different than mine. But, you know, if you can, and let me ask you this, is your husband a Star Wars fan?
Yes, very much so. He's a little bit more Trek than Star Wars. But he endures it when I put it on. So, he actually legit likes it too. So
it's funny because you know, after Return of the Jedi, which premiered in 1983, you know, there was not a lot of Star Wars, and among the hardcore fans, we call the period that you know, that followed the Return of the Jedi in the late 80s and 90s as the dark times, because George Lucas stopped, you know, producing Star Wars movies. He was obviously concentrating on other things, but there was a period in time where there weren't any novels. There's no comic books, obviously no movies, and super obvious there were no television shows. You know, George Lucas during the time was practicing and developing technology to be able to bring Star Wars to the small screen through the Young Indiana Jones Chronicles. And they were doing, him and ILM were doing a lot of work to try to, formulate a way to bring, bigger than life cinematics to the small screen. Which to me, I think, one of the reasons that I love Star Wars and George Lucas and Industrial Light and Magic is because of the technology. It's fabulous to be able to think that, these artists at ILM just created this galaxy out of nothing. Obviously the ideas came from George, but from Ralph McQuarrie to the camera people, the John Dykstras, the Ben Burtz of the group, really kind of pulled together their resource, their imagination, and blood, sweat, and tears to create this galaxy that everybody loves. But that being said, like I said, the 90s were the dark times for us. There was nothing around. When The Force Awakens, actually before The Force Awakens, obviously we had the prequels, which you mentioned, in 1999. There was incredible hype for the prequels, The Phantom Menace. Yeah.
Oh, I remember that. It was like every McDonald's container, right, or KFC container, like every cereal box had Maul or something like that.
It was, the hype, I don't think any other franchise or any other movie announcement has reached the level that the hype reached during that time, right before The Phantom Menace came out. Obviously, fans were kind of chomping at the bit to get more Star Wars. George announced that, he's getting ready to do three more trilogies. We were tickled pink.
And it wasn't just three more trilogies. It was about three more trilogies about everybody's favorite character.
Exactly. Exactly. Do you remember, what are some of the other things that you remember about the hype during the pre-prequel era?
Well, it's a little bit difficult because at that time I was in university and working, so that sort of consumed most of my life. But my friends, again, my roommate was, and her friends were really big Star Wars nerds. And it was funny that, there was discourse around the prequel trilogy. I think the consensus was they liked it, but there was aspects they didn't like. Like I know Phantom Menace got kind of slammed pretty hard. People were picking on Hayden Christensen's acting, but I always kind of remember because I said to my roommate, I go, you guys slammed the prequel trilogy, or the Phantom Menace. You guys picked on Hayden Christensen. Why are you so excited about the next movie if you didn't care for the previous two? And her response was like, you can still enjoy the Chinese buffet just because you don't get the spring rolls.
Wow, that's a great analogy. And I think, I will add that Star Wars fans are fickle, and you've seen that on Twitter already. When it comes to fandom, I always say, I know people that left the fandom after The Last Jedi, and we'll get to that. They did not see Solo. They didn't care to see Solo, and they've never seen any of the new television shows. They just stopped being fans for their own reasons. And I can't imagine doing that because I grew up with a franchise so embedded, like I said, in my DNA. I always say that, one of my sticking points is the sequel trilogy is okay, but that middle film for me is the one that that really chaps my hide. But it's one of those things that, and I think I I remember telling this to a friend. I said, you know, I'm a Star Wars fan. I will always be a Star Wars fan. And I don't want to give The Last Jedi that power to knock me off of that that trajectory of being a Star Wars fan. And of course, you know, people can choose to like or dislike whatever. It just obviously it depends on how far you take it. I made a you know, in our show notes, I kind of gave you a little preamble and a little joke, obviously saying that I'm not the kind of guy that burns action figures on YouTube or you know, screams at Kathleen Kennedy, you know, as somebody that you know, et cetera, et cetera. You've seen those accounts. Yeah. Let's fast forward a little bit to December of 2015, and we get some more Star Wars hype with, I think, when the first trailer was dropped. It was San Diego Comic-Con when everybody just rushed to social media to see the latest trailer of The Force Awakens. People usually ask you, you know, where were you when Kennedy was shot, or where were you during, you know, 9/11? This is another benchmark in history when people ask you, where were you when The Force Awakens trailer dropped? Do you remember?
To be honest, I don't really remember the trailer.
Oh, okay.
I don't know if Star Wars was sort of actively in my conscious at that time. I don't remember the Force Awakens trailer like I do The Last Jedi.
Okay.
But I do remember the hype about the fact that Star Wars was coming back.
Right, right.
And that it was going to have sequel trilogy characters. Or sorry, the original trilogy characters. So I do remember that hype. I just don't recall seeing any trailers that come, and that was on me, you know, like I just didn't pay attention.
Chewie, we're home.
And remind me, you said you saw The Force Awakens, but on television?
Yes.
Solo was your first.
And that was after. Yeah, I saw The Force Awakens after The Last Jedi came out.
Okay. All right. Yeah. And then Solo was your first movie, like big screen experience for Star Wars.
Yes.
Okay. I got you. Yeah. All right. So give me your general thoughts on The Force Awakens, since that is the one that you kind of nonchalantly got into. Give me your general thoughts on The Force Awakens.
Okay. Well, first of all, I love the movie. You ask me, if you were to ask me what's my favorite movie, it's either going to be that or A New Hope. And I go back and forth between the two, depending on how I feel. I thought it was deep. I thought it was interesting. I thought that I liked the fact that the show started off with the three main characters wearing a mask. And as the show progressed, you saw that mask, both external and internal, start to slip. And then at the end, you're seeing their faces, right? Like it's just exposed. I'll be honest with you. I kind of like that dynamic between Rey and Finn and Rey and Kylo Ren. I mean, let's not pretend I'm not a Raylo. And that's not a dirty word. You know, I write fan fiction for Christ's sake. So, you know, let's not pretend I'm not, you know, but I like the dynamic. I caught probably the dynamic before if I had watched The Force Awakens, I probably would have caught the dynamic than most people did, where they caught that dynamic in The Last Jedi. I love the emotional impact of Han Solo and, first of all, it blew my mind. I mean, my God, I was like, this is what I've been missing all my life. Wow. Like the graphics, the scene where Hux was like doing basically like a parody of like almost like it was the scariest thing I've ever seen when he was doing that sort of that Nazi-ish kind of speech.
Today is the end of the Republic. The end of a regime that acquiesces to disorder. At this very moment, in a system far from here, the New Republic lies to the galaxy while secretly supporting the treachery of the loathsome resistance.
And just like you could see the spit coming out of his mouth. And I was just like so in awe of the graphics and just everything about it. And just it sometimes it just hits. And the music was amazing. Sure. The music, like when Ray goes sliding down the hill, it hit me in every cell of my skin.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely. I think, Star Wars, if anything, is, 50% of it is really the emotion that the music uses to draw you into the narrative. It's interesting that you picked The Force Awakens and A New Hope. There were a lot of people whose first complaint was that it was kind of a retread of A New Hope. You have a desert dweller, you have secret plans in a droid, et cetera, et cetera. So there were a lot of people that were just kind of, making a checklist between the two films. And I think I remember that was one of the biggest complaints when it came to TFA, as they call it.
I'm familiar with that because when I, my first reaction after watching The Force Awakens was going to my not fandom Twitter account, which I keep, secret. And one of my friends is like, it's just a retelling of A New Hope, right? I'm like, oh, for Christ's sakes. But you know what? And I thought to myself, like, why is that a bad thing? A New Hope is awesome.
Right, yeah.
It's it's awesome start. It's intentionally, I thought it was intentionally supposed to be sort of a similar foundation to kind of root you in that familiarity. If A New Hope was shit, then yeah, you can maybe pick on it. But A New Hope was amazing. So why would people be upset? And it was different enough, in my opinion, that if that's your worst complaint is that it's a retelling of New Hope, then those are kind of first world problems here, for Star Wars.
Yeah, absolutely. I almost feel too that there was, George had just sold Star Wars to Disney. Disney paid almost $4.5 billion. That's a billion with a B. And, it's one of those things where I feel like the investors were like, all right, we just spent all this money. What do you got? Let's chop with a new Star Wars. And, one of the other criticisms was that, they played it safe. They said, Star Wars worked on a deep level with everyone. Let's kind of just let's try to capture lightning in a bottle.
And I think that's fair.
And and I think you're right. I think, it's not a bad thing. I think out of the three films that we're going to be discussing tonight, I think The Force Awakens is probably my favorite of the three.
Mm-hmm. But I can understand the criticism of The Force. This is the first time that you have the opportunity to have the characters that you loved in the original trilogy to be together, and by the end of that movie, it wasn't going to happen because one of the characters was dead, and that Luke wouldn't be there. This is kind of more of a Last Jedi criticism when we're going to get to that about what I kind of feel about the Luke dynamic. But I can understand the critique of, you've been, and especially, I can't really understand the critique of people who've built it up in their head and it didn't come out exactly as they want. But I can understand the critique that to have a movie that everybody knows, buying the merch, dressing the cosplay, wanting the original trilogy characters back, and to not get that, I can understand why some people would be like, eh. And then to kill Han Solo on top of it, like my husband was freaking livid. He loved the movie. He absolutely loved the movie, but my God, was he mad? And he's still mad. You ask him about them and it's like he's triggered.
Yeah, I mean, I think you hit that right on the head. I think the You know, George Lucas, before selling to Disney, you know, I read that he went to the old actors and he said, hey, I'd love to do another Star Wars movie and I need you guys in it. And, you know, Carrie Fisher's like, OK, that's interesting. I'm in. Harrison Ford. OK, fine. George, you're a good guy. I'm in. Mark Hamill's like, let's do it. And I feel like George Lucas did the heavy lifting when it comes to, you know, building a framework for a story that could have come out of a first movie in a new trilogy. But you're absolutely right. I think a couple of days ago, I had posted a question asking folks, you know, was it a mistake to never see the three original characters in the trilogy at all? And a lot of people obviously said yes. There were some people that said no because the story didn't fit.
It was.
And that, you know, that kind of critique is kind of after the fact because, you know, you can create a story, you know, starting from scratch to make it happen. And I think, like you said, I think the hardcore fans or the fans that have been on this franchise since the beginning really wanted to see that. There was, I think, you know, for the most part, this will be a bold statement, but I think we didn't go to see a new Star Wars to see these new characters. We went to go see Han, Luke, and Leia. One more adventure, one last time. And
I think it's important to grow a story, to bring in new fans. I mean, you know, I love seeing every Halloween, I get a little Rey that comes up to my door. I think it's important to build that, but you can't neglect the bread and butter, you know, like the bread and butter fans, the ones that are going to be there when the other fans have moved on to watching, you know, the other viewers have moved on to watching something else. You know, your hardcore fans are going to be out there buying the books and, you know, making the podcasts and talking about it ad nauseum. I mean, you know, I get it. You know, do I understand the menace behind some of the hate? No, but I get why people were upset. I can still, you can like something and still be upset.
Sure.
You know, it is possible to like Star Wars, like a film, but be upset because certain things don't happen and be disappointed. And I think that's, you know, we can't be afraid to say that feelings are valid, good and bad, you know?
Hey friends, just a quick reminder, if you enjoy our content and don't want to commit to a Patreon tier, you can show your love in other ways.
Oh, yeah.
Of course, you can take advantage of our merchandise store at TeePublic, where we've got cool designs from all across the Red 5 network. Look for sale announcements and save up to 30 to 35% on all our merchandise.
Oh, nice.
And there's also a very convenient way to help support the channel. As you know, coffee is our friend. It keeps us going. You can show your appreciation by heading over to buymeacoffee.com/scarif.
buymeacoffee.com/scarif.
Any amount starting at $5, a one-time treat for us to help with all the stuff it takes to maintain the quality you deserve. And remember, it's always sunny on Scarif, and that's the scuttlebutt. And pass the cream, please.
The opportunity awaits to listen to the Captain's Quadrant for the other Star Sci-Fi podcast. Yes, Star Trek. We have loads of fun talking edgy and forgettable classic episodes in the Agony Booth. Hear our love of current Trek and deep cuts with jokes every Thursday live at 9 p.m. Eastern Time.
Hey there, kids and cadets. It's Tim from the FSF Popcast, and you're listening to the Scarif Podcast, and that's the Scuttlebutt.
Hey, it's Obi-Wan Kenobi. You're listening to the Scarif Podcast, and that's the Scuttlebutt.
Hey, this is Todd Hoffman from WSTR Galactic Public Access and Big T Little T Podcast. You're listening to the Scarif Podcast, and that's the Scuttlebutt.
Hello, this is Hondo Onaka. You are listening to the Scarif Podcast, and that's the Scuttlebutt. Okay, cut. Who has my credits? I must get going. I'm being chased by the Empire, after all.
Tune into the Scarif Scuttlebutt Podcast. Deep dives, geek talk, and an occasional butt. Only on the Red 5 Network. Yeah, you said it again. I mean, I think the fans that I always say that there are certain type of fans, I guess older fans who have spent so much time with Star Wars. And obviously you can see behind me, I have so much invested in the franchise that, you know, to be able to for a company to kind of cut off its nose to spite its face, or however the saying goes, it's kind of puzzling to me. And I think, I don't know, it's obviously, you know, a huge movie studio doesn't set out to do a movie to make it fail. Obviously they want to make as much money as they can, but I think they really kind of went about it the wrong way. And I think,
well, possibly, but it's what we got.
Yeah.
And that's where I think, you know, you have to settle and decide, like, you know, do you want no Star Wars, or do you want, you know, the Star Wars that you're going to get? Like, I mean, I let's go back to the, you know, the Bond franchise, right? You're going to have the Sean Connery purist, the Roger Moore purist, the, you know, Daniel Craig's not my Bond, you know, whatever the case may be.
I didn't even know that happened.
Or you know, or for every, like, you know, for every Casino Royale, there's a Quantum of Solace, right? You know, like you're going to have that. But I just think that, like, I think you should allow yourself to enjoy the aspects you like getting Star Wars, and the hope that they're going to learn from fans being vocal. And I don't mind fans having discourse about it or not liking it. It's just that, you know, I also kind of wonder with some fans, whether, you know, is it really their view, or is it because, you know, they tune into the grifters, sure, and the podcast, and they haven't, you know, have you watched it again? Because sometimes you can watch it the first time, like with me with Rogue One. The first time I watched Rogue One, I was like, what the hell is that? You know, the second time I watched it, I'm like, is this becoming my favorite movie? You know, like, you know, and I think sometimes you can watch and it's not the right mood to be watching a film. I think sometimes, you know, you can go back and you'll catch something different that maybe you didn't notice the first time. And I think that it's, you know, it's okay to give a fair chance and still have the critique that you have.
Yeah.
And, you know, I mean, the other option is no Star Wars.
Yeah. And I ask myself that. I sometimes talk to my friends about that. Would I rather have no Star Wars or have the Star Wars that I have with everything that has happened? You know, I think that's a very difficult question. You know,
and for some people it's going to be,
yeah, for some people it's going to be no, they walked away from the fandom and, you know, I get that decision, but I can't, you know, when something is announced, when something is, you know, a new, like this Acolyte show or the Skeleton Crew show, I mean, all this, you know, we're getting new Star Wars, whether people want it or not, we're getting new Star Wars, and I'm still excited because I like Star Wars. And if you tell me that something is Star Wars, I'm like, I'm all in for it. I'll, you know, it's, I don't know. You have to make your decision. If you want to talk about it, you know, watch it. You like it, you don't like it, talk about it with other fans and make your peace and move on.
Or maybe give another, like, maybe you don't like the sequel trilogy, but maybe watch Andor, or maybe watch, you know, Mandalorian, and you might like that aspect, sure, of it. And it might be enough to bring you back into the front, into Star Wars, recognizing that, you know, this aspect you're going to put on the shelf and that's not going to be what you like. And that's fine.
Yeah, so let's talk about how people perceive Star Wars now because of The Last Jedi. And I think this is related to your post. Like I said earlier, I have friends that left the fandom because they didn't like The Last Jedi. They didn't like what it did to the franchise, to the character of Luke Skywalker, to whatever the reason is. It is what it is. But I wanted to get your take and give me your, I guess, your reasoning by – you had posted that post regarding rewatching The Last Jedi. And tell me a little bit about that and your experience on your rewatch.
It's time to let old things die. Snoke, Skywalker, the Sith, the Jedi, the Rebels, let it all die. Rey, I want you to join me. We can rule together and bring a new order to the galaxy.
Don't do this, Ben. Please don't go this way.
No, no, you're still holding on! Let go!
Okay, so I was watching, I didn't watch, you know, again, I told you there's that one channel, and it seems like every long weekend there's a Star Wars marathon, right? And so I didn't watch it this time around, but I did catch a little bit of the one scene in The Last Jedi where they were on Crait. And Luke was peak Luke, and Kylo was peak Kylo, and they were, it's just, holy crap, you know what I mean? It was just like such a scene, and I thought to myself, it's like, you know, can we acknowledge that sometimes movies can stink but still have great Star Wars? You know, there can be great Star Wars within a film. And is it possible that if we can come to that understanding of that, like, you know, can we watch a film and enjoy the, and knowing that maybe we don't like it as much as the other, maybe of a list of 12 movies, it's the bottom one. You know, we understand that. But can we still enjoy the film anyways because of some of the scenes that you got and some of the amazing effects that you got and some of the amazing storyline that was in there of the movie that can you rewatch it 5 years later? You've hated it. Can you rewatch it and see if you would have a fresh take on it? Would you be as angry the second time if you watched it again? Or, you know, like, just, is it, can you do that? Like, is it possible?
Short answer for me specifically, no.
Listen, you know, The Last Jedi is kind of an interesting movie for me because when I first saw it, I loved it. Right. But I loved the Reylo part of it. I'm not going to lie. That was my jam. That was like, you know, that was what made my heart beat. But on rewatch and constant rewatch, it keeps sliding down on my list. It's the one movie that's sliding down.
Yeah.
You know, it's not at the bottom by any stretch because that's I'm not going to reveal what that one is.
Because,
okay, hold on. It's Return of the Jedi. But I hate that movie.
What does your husband think about that?
But. Oh, he's fine with it because he doesn't like it either. Yeah, well, I like it enough, but it's not my favorite. But anyways, I digress. But it's a conflicting movie for me because the highs are high, but the lows are low.
Yes.
You know, for every, you know, the Rey and Ben battle was fantastic, but for every, you know, killing Snoke was fantastic. The Battle of Crait was fantastic. But sidelining Finn wasn't. That whole storyline was kind of,
sure, the Jedi are romanticized, deified. But if you strip away the myth and look at their deeds, the legacy of the Jedi is failure, hypocrisy, hubris.
That's not true.
At the height of their powers, they allowed Darth Sidious to rise, create the Empire, and wipe them out. It was a Jedi Master who was responsible for the training and creation of Darth Vader.
And a Jedi who saved him.
I struggle with Luke. I struggle with Luke on how I feel about this one, about Luke. But you know, going back to, you know, Finn, I'm conflicted about, like, can you say that you don't care about Rose Tico without everybody assuming that you're a racist?
Right.
That you're happy that I'm happy. I love her. Sure. I think she's a great, great actress. The character was fine. Do I think she was necessary? Right. You know, because her, if her purpose was to teach Finn, who had spent his entire life, like, you know, basically kidnapped from childhood and raised to be a killing machine and fight, like, he's the last person who needs a morality lesson, you know? So, but what I find is difficult is the discourse that is about the movie, or is the discourse that people assume the worst about other people's opinions?
Yes. And I think, I'm probably going to filter out some of the strong, opinions that come from, like you called them, the grifters and the YouTubers
and the racists
and all that stuff. I'm really not.
And the obvious racist,
I'm not interested in their opinions at all. I think one of the things that I am interested in, it's funny to me because when I post about the sequel trilogy, people tell me they absolutely hate The Rise of Skywalker. And to me, that's like mind blowing because I'm like, how can you hate the Rise of Skywalker when The Last Jedi is right there? It's right there, you know?
But The Last Jedi had some like amazing visuals and
it better for $300 million.
For many years there was balance, and then I saw Ben, my nephew, with that mighty Skywalker blood, and in my hubris I thought I could train him, I could pass on my strengths. Han was Han about it, but Leia trusted me with her son. I took him and a dozen students and began the training temple. By the time I realized I was no match for the darkness rising in him, it was too late.
What happened?
Some people I think maybe like that subverting of expectations, and some people kind of don't. And I'm of the opinion that there's a time and a place for that. I'm not quite sure if that was the time and the place, but for other people, they might think differently. And but it doesn't make it a bad movie by any stretch. Like, you got to understand, when I say a movie's at my 12th or 11th spot, that's still better than every other movie in my on my shelf, right? Like, I love the Star Wars, and like my least favorite movie, I still like it.
Sure. You know, yeah. Like,
I don't like aspects of it, but I like it.
You know, for me, The Last Jedi is the only Star Wars movie that I never bought on DVD or Blu-ray or digital or at all. And it's a movie that I don't feel like revisiting. I walked out of that movie thinking to myself, what the hell? Questioning my fandom. It even had that power for a little bit. And it's a weird dynamic. It's a weird relationship that I, you know, obviously I was not alone. I think the biggest part for me was the fact that Rian Johnson was a little too headstrong when it came to hearing what other people had to say about his film. I think he doubled down a little bit, calling some fans, you know, names. I mean, some fans deserve to be called some, you know, names, but I think there are other fans that had some legitimate concerns and critiques that I guess that aspect of the narrative were clumped in with everybody. And, you know, my biggest problem with the film is really, I think, the biggest problem that a lot of people had with the film. I think Luke Skywalker's characterization in that film didn't fly with me. And obviously, you know, everybody is familiar with Luke, with Mark Hamill's voicing of his, you know, his opinion about Luke Skywalker in the film. You know, I always go back to the Luke's motivation in The Last Jedi. You know, he just wanted to kind of put himself off the grid. But I don't feel that anyone with half a brain would use that as a plan B or a plan A on how to defeat evil. I think that I always go back to that adage, and I'm sure you've heard of this, is evil evil rises when good men do nothing. And I can't for the life of me find it plausible that someone like Luke Skywalker, who had so much faith and hope, obviously he was the new hope, to say, you know what, fuck it. I'm just going to die and the galaxy is going to do what the galaxy is going to do. I find that very difficult to believe and difficult to swallow in my case.
Master Yoda.
Young Skywalker.
I'm ending all of this. The tree, the text, the Jedi. I'm going to burn it down.
I have somewhat similar thoughts to you, and I think that might surprise you, because as much as I love the sequel trilogy, my biggest issue might be Luke. And here's the thing. I can certainly understand that grumpy old man aspect. I mean, hell, I'm 45. I'm starting to become grumpy old woman. I get it. Half the fandom is grumpy old men. So, it shouldn't be that much of a stretch to understand how a failure could totally shatter your, especially with family. You were entrusted with family and you failed on such an epic level. I can understand how can that shatter you as a person. The difficulty that I have is that in the original trilogy, Luke would never abandon Leia. Luke would never abandon his friends. He shortened his training with Yoda because his friends were in trouble.
Right.
And yet Rey comes and it's the galaxy in trouble. And he's like, yeah, to hell with them. Fuck my sister. Yeah. Sorry.
I swore already.
Yeah. Okay. That's where I kind of struggle. It's I get the point you're trying to make about Luke. I think you can push a character to a point and, Luke redeemed himself in the end, and Luke was peak Luke in the end. That was the Luke that we were expecting to see. I don't understand how he would just say, even in the first movie, he should have come back in the first movie much earlier. Yeah. I don't think we needed Crate or Acto.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Acto. Yeah. I don't think we needed that island. I think he could have come back when they were in danger in The Force Awakens, and that could have, even if Ryan Johnson pushes the boundaries in The Force in The Last Jedi, after Luke comes back in The Force Awakens, then, at least it's the Luke we know and they're pushing boundaries. At least he still came back and was heroic for his sister. But I just have this hard time disconnecting this idea that Luke wouldn't come back for his sister.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, I totally agree with you. And I think, our ardent fans of The Last Jedi always point out to the lessons that Luke learned in The Last Jedi. And I always say, he learned those lessons in the original trilogy. He was tempted, but he surpassed that. So I think, that is one aspect of the sequel trilogy that I think is also part of my discontent with the overall sequel trilogy. I think they succeeded to deconstruct the original characters just to kind of bring them up again. But we already saw that in the original trilogy. It's one of those things that I don't understand why they did it. And I think also, you mentioned that it's good to see new characters for a new audience. And I think one of the biggest reasons that I feel that the sequel trilogy works for younger audiences is because they don't know Luke Skywalker. They didn't grow up with him, his stories. And obviously, he only appears in these three movies, but we do have, a litany of expanded universe, material that fans like I said, have read everything during the dark times. You'd had, you know, some of the novels starting with, you know, all the Timothy Zahn stuff in the mid 90s and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And all the books that that people really, you know, fell in love with. And that's another aspect of the anger of fans when Disney decided to decanonize those stories and say, you know what, those were stories that happened, but they didn't happen in our galaxy. So, you know.
But were they ever really fully canon, though? That's the thing I don't understand. Not. Like, I can understand the fantasy and enjoying the book, but, and you know, I think one of the things that they're starting to cleverly do is reintroduce characters. Now, they're not going to be the same way that they were in the Legends material, but I mean, they're bringing, you know, they brought back Thrawn. Was Cad Bane in the books or whatever? Like, you know.
I don't think Cad Bane was, but yeah,
but,
you're right.
But even amongst the legends, like, you know, the name I keep hearing is Mara Jade, but there's people that were like, what the hell, Luke got married? Right. Like, you know, they don't like the Mara Jade character. George Lucas didn't. So I just think that, you know, there's clever ways to bring back these characters in a new reality and make it their own. And one of the things that I like about these new characters, about the Finns, the Rays, the, you know, I mean, you know, I mean, at the time I thought maybe Ben Solo, but that came out for nothing, you know, but, you know, Carrie died.
Yeah.
Mark Hamill's an old man. Harrison Ford's an old man.
Sure.
You know, these people aren't going to be here forever. And that, you know, that franchise that you guys have spent 40 plus years nursing and caring for, do you want it to die when you die? Right. Do you know what I mean? Like, so at some point you've got to grow it for these children. These children have to have their Star Wars. And it's not for you to say what's right for the children. Just like, you know, nobody told you what was right for you as a child.
Yeah.
So, you know, I just think that, like, I can understand that possessive quality that you want over Star Wars, but there has to be some sort of a give and take. There has to, I think it's fair to say that as original trilogy fans, maybe you felt you were done a little dirty. Mm-hmm. And I get that. That I absolutely get. And maybe, you know, Star Wars should have given more consideration to that. You know, Disney and Lucasfilm and Kathleen or whoever should have given more consideration to that. But, you know, we got what we got. And the impetus was focusing on these new characters who were going to carry on the legacy. So those guys' storylines were great. I mean, you know, we can talk about Finn's story in the middle there and maybe Poe, you know, in the middle there. But those guys' stories were great. And, you know, if that's the stories that I enjoy because they resonate with me, you know, and they're gonna resonate with my, you know, my friends' daughters.
Yeah.
Who are all, you know, they love Rey. They love everything about Rey. They love Finn. They love Poe. They love BB-8. My God, they love BB-8. You know, like, you know, so for them, it's like, you know, Leia's cool. Luke's cool. But, you know, they're not Rey. Sure. They're not Finn. You know?
Yeah, I think, you know, Star Wars obviously has become such a big deal. It is generational. I think one of the biggest arguments that I hear is, you know, where I think older fans are fine with new characters. I think one of the biggest reasons that we are so bitter is because, like you said, because they did us dirty. We don't have a scene of the original trilogy actors, characters in the, you know, in a scene. I think, you know, The Force Awakens or the sequel trilogy in general doesn't even seem like a series of films that that portray an essence of handing the torch over to a new generation. I think
that's going to be determined, though. 20 years later, when at the time, 20 years ago, it was slammed, is because you got the Clone Wars. The Clone Wars changed the prequel trilogy for my husband. Sure. The Clone Wars added depth, it added the story, it added flavor. So what's going to be the things that fill in the sequel trilogy? Is it going to be this Rey movie? You know, are we going to get some sort of animated Clone Wars-like thing between the, you know, the Rise of Skywalker and the Rey movie? Or are we going to move in a completely different direction? Should we just park the sequel trilogy and yeah, we'll have the Rey movie, but maybe the Rey movie is what's going to launch that next set of stories. Maybe they realize, you know, the sequel trilogy didn't do its job of launching the next set. So that's what the Rey movie is going to address. We don't know, you know, but I think it's fair to park the sequel trilogy. If you didn't like it, just park it, but understand that there's more other Star Wars sure. to like.
Yeah, I find that that question interesting, too, is the question always arises regarding the prequel trilogy and its relationship to the Clone Wars animated series and how obviously those prequel films were enhanced because of the animated series and everything that has happened between those two shows. And it's you know, for me at this point, I have such a distaste for what The Last Jedi did to Star Wars that I don't see anything from my perspective. I don't see anything on the horizon that will make me all lovey-dovey on The Last Jedi. It's just, yeah.
And that's fine. I think that's valid. You should be able to feel that way.
Yeah.
You know, you don't have to justify it, to be honest. Like, and looking at Star Wars now, is maybe, again, maybe it's okay to park the sequel trilogy. If you liked it, you liked it. If you didn't, you didn't. Because I think the future of Star Wars is really kind of resting right now on The Mandalorian and less on the sequel trilogy.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think, you know, they made an announcement. Obviously, a Rey movie is happening. The Mandoverse movie mm-hmm. is supposedly moving forward. And I think there was a third an announcement or rumor that they were going into another historical realm of Star Wars with the High Republic and possibly that being a movie. Mm-hmm. But I know The Acolyte kind of deals with a little bit of that era. I almost feel like Disney is testing the waters to see, you know, we're going to do three movies in three different, you know, time periods of Star Wars. Let's see what sticks. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And you know, one of the things too, that I'm curious about is because it's clear that everything about this Mandoverse is leading up to The Force Awakens. Are we going to, whatever comes out, are we going to look back at the sequel trilogy slightly differently because of whatever comes out of this Mandalorian buildup, because it's leading up to The Force Awakens. So are we going to look at it with fresh eyes because of what the Mandalorian did, in the same way that the Clone Wars helped the prequel trilogy? Is the Mandalorian universe stories going to help the sequel trilogy? Or at least an aspect of the sequel trilogy, where then you're going to want to rewatch it just to kind of see if it clicks and it makes sense. Like, yeah. I don't know.
The jury is still out, as they say.
Yeah. Time is a great healer.
Yeah. That's interesting. I think, like I said, you know, for me, it's a tough sell. I do want to, I think I do want Star Wars to kind of move past the sequel trilogy. I think I think shows like Andor have really kind of showed us that there are stories to be told in that universe that really don't rely on the bigger picture, you know, Sith mm-hmm. and Jedi and this and that. I think, you know, there are regular people that live in that galaxy. And I think Andor really, for me at least, for a lot of people that enjoyed that series, that is like more of what I want in Star Wars.
Oh, me too. Oh, I love Andor. If you were to ask me, like, post-sequel trilogy, which is my favorite series, you know, up until season three, I would have said, but sure. Season three was a bit of a disappointment for me. So I'm going to go back to Andor. Andor blew my mind. Andor was just,
absolutely.
It hit me in the same way that watching Star Wars for the first time hit
And
me.
It's funny because, you know, we're adults. I think, you know, for somebody who saw Star Wars at 8 years old, if I saw Andor at 8 years old, I might be bored to tears. But mm-hmm. I think there's something special about a grown-up Star Wars, if I use the term. You know, Andor mm-hmm. was written so well. And I know a lot of people have a problem with Andor because it didn't have any Jedi or Sith or lightsabers, et cetera, et cetera. There was a certain aspect of the fandom that proclaimed that Andor was not Star Wars because it was missing those certain elements. And I understand that. But I think, you know, I always said that after watching Andor, for me, it was very difficult to go back to regular Star Wars. And I think season three of Mandalorian was after Andor. And like you, I was very disappointed in season three of Mando, especially after coming out of such a well-written show as Andor. I think it was top-tier Star Wars. It was top-tier drama for the most part.
Well, you know what? My favorite prequel trilogy movie is Attack of the Clones. And that's going to surprise people. And Attack of the Clones is actually in either my top three or top four. Because sometimes it's got to be behind Empire. So, okay, maybe it's the fourth one. But I love, you know, if the first movie in the prequel trilogy was the rise of, you know, how Anakin came to be, and the third movie was how Anakin came to fall, Attack of the Clones literally set up the storyline that is still carrying all these films later. All the politics, all the juicy, you know, sort of like the intrigue, the Sith versus that. And I think that's what I like about Andor is, like, you know, Star Wars can't be all lightsabers and Jedi versus, because that gets boring after a while. I want to see, like, what causes people to join the dark side.
Spies. Saboteurs. Assassins. We've all done terrible things on behalf of the rebellion.
Cassian Andor. Don't matter what you tell me or tell yourself. You'll ultimately die fighting these bastards. Wouldn't you rather give it all at once to something real?
What causes people to fight for, you know, the enemy or whatever? Like, and then when you're watching, like, you know, they're working these office careers, they're treated like a number, you know, everybody's fighting to become ambitious. Like, I love that. And I think maybe that's kind of like, I'm hoping these next few films will give us a different aspect of it. But what I worry about is if it's not lightsabers and pew, 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 will people like it? Like, I think, you know, or can we have, like, you know, some Star Wars is going to deal with pew, pew, pew and lightsabers, and other Star Wars is going to be, you know, the intrigue, why people fall, why people join, why, what's the cause, what's the desperation that makes people make the decisions they make. And I think we need to allow for the fact that that's what makes the Star Wars universe rich, is all these stories. It's not just, you know, I mean, literally, if I'm just going to watch 8 hours of, you know, 16 hours of Empire Strikes Back, I'm going to sleep. You know, like, we need each movie to stand alone on its own and bring a different aspect of it. I think the sequel trilogy tried in many ways. I liked it, but I get why people don't. I think The Rise of Skywalker was, you know, I agree with you where a lot of people hated it. I think it was the closest thing to coming back to what I think maybe fans would have envisioned the sequel trilogy to be.
Sure.
Like, I think you can watch the first movie and the last movie and have a basic knowledge of what happened between Rey and Kylo Ren, and you're not missing anything if you didn't like the middle movie.
Yeah, and it's funny because that's not how a trilogy should work, unfortunately. It's too bad. You know, I think I would I would have greater respect for Disney if they said, you know what, we tried something, didn't work, let's move on. But I think at this point we can only hear that apology through their actions.
Well, and for me, you know, it's funny because I was the big champion of the sequel trilogy. When everybody was hating it, I was just like, yeah, rah, rah, you know. But when they killed Ben Solo, I was devastated and I couldn't understand the decision. And, you know, people are going to say, oh, he's a villain, blah, 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 blah. But why then did they save Ben for him to die 30 seconds later? Like, Jesus Christ, you know? And so in that sense, you know, as much as I love the sequel trilogy, it ended on a sour note for me.
Sure.
And I like The Rise of Skywalker, but it ended on a sour note for me. You know? So how do we look at the sequel trilogy as a whole? It was like, you know, it's almost like a live action role play game where, you know, you have a guy that sets the story, but then he lets the characters create what they want. And maybe you're going to get something good and maybe you're going to get something good, but you need that, that manager to manage the story a little bit better. And that's maybe what we needed, is a stronger finger on the pulse of the story, or at least a shell of an outline of what they wanted to get to.
Right.
Instead of letting these directors make their own decisions. I mean, I had a chance to listen to that Duel of the Fates podcast. Someone had recorded, did sort of a live action reading. You can find it on YouTube. And there was elements of that story where it's like, you know, oh, that might've been an okay Star Wars.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah. I think, you know, unfortunately, I think with JJ and Johnson, to me, the sequel trilogy, especially the last two films, it felt like a pissing match between directors. One was doing one thing, the other one was kind of undoing the other thing. And I think,
well, they boxed each other in. They boxed each other in.
Yeah.
And so they had to kind of evolve the story from that, you know?
Yeah.
And then it didn't help. I don't think it helped too, where Disney didn't, you know, once Colin Trevorrow was dropped, they should have extended the amount of time it took for JJ to make the film and maybe even, you know, maybe even broken it up into two stories.
Sure.
Why the rush? Why was the rush? And I think they learned their lesson from that.
Yeah, I think the rush obviously was due to the fact that it's big business and they wanted, they wanted their return on investment.
But at what cost?
Yeah. Well,
you know.
Yeah. That's
like here we are talking about it. But I do want to clarify. I still love the sequel trilogy. I still find joy. And I, going back to when that, the thing about like the crate, I can still watch it, notice something different, enjoy something different, enjoy a different storyline, or notice something that it's like, yeah, you know, that kind of bugs me. And I think that for some people, I keep wondering if they watched it again, sat down and watched all three movies in a row, you know, had the showcase special in Canada over the long weekend and they're at home and they're full of turkey and they're, you know, would they kind of maybe appreciate it more, especially if you haven't watched it since then? Mm-hmm. If you've only watched it once, you know, would you give it more of a chance if you saw it the second time? Would something hit differently that maybe you didn't notice in your first watch? And that's where I'm saying, like, or can you extract like, hey, these were good pieces and it's not worth all this fandom discourse when, you know, it's not really all that bad, or it's bad, but I don't need to be a dick.
Right. Yeah, no, absolutely. Absolutely. Again, short answer for me, I don't think I can watch the first and the third movie. Again, mm-hmm. I don't have the stomach at this point in my life to watch The Last Jedi. And that's, it is what it is.
And like I said, that's completely fair. I mean, and it's funny because I never really understood Last Jedi haters mm-hmm. until the Book of Boba Fett came out. And then I'm like, oh, I get it now. You know? I get it now.
That's another podcast.
If you want to say, you know, Mr., you know, I'm a little Miss Super Positivity here. And, you know, I'm not a Disney shill by any stretch. Don't get me wrong. But, you know, I can definitively say I did not like the Book of Boba Fett.
I don't think a lot of people.
Except the Cobb Vanth part. Yeah, sure. I could have had a whole series on Cobb Vanth and Cad Bane, but the rest of it, I was like, oh God, kill me now.
Yeah, I hear you.
I won't be rewatching that one, so I get it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, again, this has been fantastic. You know, we never did a sequel trilogy review or a review of any of the films in the sequel trilogy since Brad and I started the podcast back in 2019. Because, you know, it's one of those things, if you don't like it, then just move on. But Dani, thank you so much for challenging me to talk about the sequel trilogy. I don't think I've ever talked about it in depth as we did on the show. So thank you very much.
Yeah, well, I hope I was okay for my time with you, and that I offered something or some new insight.
Absolutely. I think, folks that are listening to this, I'm sure you have opened their eyes a little bit as far as how to look at the sequel trilogy. And as Star Wars fans, we know that the way we look at things is different from a certain point of view. See what I did there?
Yes. Oh, whatever.
Excellent. Dani, thank you so much. Why don't you tell the fine folks that are still listening how to find you to say hello there?
I'm on Twitter, or no, X, what is it called? Twitter X at Semperfi Dani. And I'm on Discord at Semperfi Dani too, but I generally just stick to Raylo pages there, so don't add me.
Excellent. Dani, thank you so much. And you know what, I we did have a one of my followers, Nin Sage, brought in a 20-minute discourse on the sequel trilogy. I will tack that on to the end and see mm-hmm. what everybody thinks about his opinion. I might have him back and just talk about his thoughts and his feelings on the sequel trilogy. I think we opened a floodgate here when as it's concerning with the sequel trilogy. So it's too funny, but we'll see what happens.
Well, at some point too, we have to move on from
yes,
it.
Yes, absolutely.
And just, park the sequel trilogy where it is and decide for yourself whether you want to enjoy more Star Wars or if there's a Star Wars for you to enjoy. Just park it and move on and enjoy for what the stuff that you do enjoy now. Whether it's the Andors or the Mandalorians, sure. Just, put it in the distance past. There's no sense keep fighting about it because it's stupid at this point. The movie's 5 years old or 10 years old. Right. Like, let's just move on,
Well, I parked it back in 2018, but you opened up that wound. So thank you for that.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I moved on.
Look at me pouring the salt.
Excellent. Dani, yeah. Dani, thank you so much for joining me on this episode of the Scarif Scuttlebutt podcast. And folks, if you're listening, thank you very much for joining us on episode 182. Is it 182? Yeah, 182 or 181. You look it up. I can't remember which one it is. But thank you again for joining us on this edition of the Scarif Scuttlebutt podcast. For more of the show and more of the Red 5 Network, head on over to bio.link/red5. If you guys have any comments regarding our discussion on tonight's show, give us a call. Leave us a voicemail at 773-234-8659. Come on down and we'll check it out. Thank you very much. Until next time, that's the Scuttlebutt.
World. This is Nin Sage, and I'm here to talk to you about my view on the sequel trilogy, the Star Wars sequel trilogy, to be more specific. So I don't generally do great with such a vague prompt, but I guess I'll just start talking and try not to make it take forever, and we'll see what happens. So I'll sort of skip my true background with Star Wars. I'll just sort of start with when the sequels came out. So by the time the sequels came out, I was still just a very, very casual Star Wars fan. I wouldn't even consider myself a Star Wars fan in 2015. I watched some stuff as a kid. I'd seen all the movies. I'd seen the prequels in theaters, but it was always just because friends were going and they wanted me to go. Similarly, with Episode 7, I had a friend who wanted to go, like the day it came out, like not midnight showing, but like the next day. And he already had a kid at the time, so it's like he could only go in the middle of the day and no one else could go. So he was like, hey, do you want to come with me so I'm not alone watching this movie? And I was like, sure. So I went, and to show how little I knew going into the film, I had heard a rumor that the dude in the black outfit called Kylo Ren might be Luke Skywalker. So from the beginning of the film up until, you know, up until they basically reveal who that is, I thought that that could very well be Luke Skywalker under that mask. So, but I was captured instantly as soon as Kylo Ren spoke. So whichever audio engineer set up his voice to sound like that, you know, the coolest thing about how much I love the character of Kylo Ren, which is, if it hasn't been made clear before, is like 100% of the reason I'm a Star Wars fan. You know, the fact that I can't fully explain like why that voice is so cool or why that character strikes such a chord with me is like half the fun. Like, it's one of the few things where I have trouble putting into words why I just am so captivated by that character. It could be Adam Driver as a great actor. Maybe I'm just a sucker for that particular costume design. But then again, I've never been like that huge of a Darth Vader fan. And I think aesthetically they're similar, certainly. But anyway, so I was just hooked. I mean, it's, you know, it's basically that first scene where he is introduced and talks. And I was just, I mean, I went from sort of like, hey, yeah, I'll check out this movie, to I was instantly just like, oh, I am fastened in. Like, let's go. Let's see what this is about. So episode 7 as a whole, perhaps because I was a casual fan, you know, what I hear is one of the biggest criticisms of that is like, oh, it's just a rehash of A New Hope. Well, if you're someone like me who, you know, I'd seen A New Hope plenty of times by then, but I never, like, I hadn't committed it all to memory or anything. So I think having basically what some people have called like a soft reboot, or having episode 7 basically serve as a refresher of what Star Wars is about and what it should feel like and what sort of story beats happen and what kind of characters there are, I think that that was a deliberate choice. I don't think there were so many similarities to A New Hope because they just couldn't think of other stuff to do. So I think that that was deliberate, and I think that that worked for me. You know, it felt like a good welcoming back in a way to the franchise, and I think that that was what they set out to do. Now, some of my biggest complaints with that movie are the rehash factor. So for instance, even that first time in the theater when you know, they show Starkiller Base and they're like, here's the Death Star and here's Starkiller Base, and it's like, unless you're like 6 years old, just seeing it and being like, oh, it's so much bigger, like, I don't know who that's supposed to impress or anything, especially because as an audience, I mean, once something is the size of a moon, can we really wrap our head around like, oh, it's a bigger moon? Well, does that make it more of a threat? Like, I don't think so. And then I also really didn't like that. I think they felt compelled, like, well, you have to blow up the big Death Star thing at the end of the first movie because that's just what you do. And I, even at the time, I thought that was kind of lame because I thought it would have been much better, if for no other reason than you'd already done that before, to have Starkiller Base as like this looming threat throughout the whole sequel trilogy, as something like, you know, unlike the Death Star, you can't just blow it up 3 hours after you discover its existence, you know. So that I wasn't crazy about. But other than that, you know, I think some of the things in episode 7 that apply to the whole trilogy are the visuals are amazing. I don't think I've ever heard anyone argue otherwise. The acting is almost universally top-notch throughout the whole trilogy. Each new character that's introduced, I think, is incredibly interesting, creative, and has amazing potential. Now, I say potential because I think a lot of people will agree, like, you know, the way that things went, the sort of disjointedness that everyone has recognized ever since episode 8 came out, which continued into 9, you know, I think that made it tough. Like, some of the potential in a character like Finn or Poe or even Rose, if you were interested in her, it was tough to really capitalize on that because all they were was potential. Like, you didn't have enough build up and consistent progress to have something pay off and feel satisfying by the end, because it's like 7 started a trajectory and then 8 started a different trajectory and then 9 sort of tried to course correct 8, and you know, it was just, it's tough to make characters live up to their potential under those circumstances. But I still think they have incredible potential. And the reason why that's still cool to me is because, you know, especially seeing what's happened with Star Wars in the last almost 20 years, there's always all these like animated spin-off shows, live action shows, books and everything. And I feel like what you can do is take the opportunity to take those characters and their potential and bring it to life in one of those areas. And I feel like that would be totally fine, especially because I feel like that's largely what changed people's opinions of the prequel movies. I mean, I was basically in college when those were coming out, and I certainly remember after the first 2, people were pretty disappointed. And then 3 came out, and I think everyone really quite liked that and felt it sort of redeemed the trilogy. And then Clone Wars came out, and then that just super redeemed the whole thing and sort of retroactively made all those characters and plot points really, really solidified as being incredible parts of the canon that everyone loves. So I think they're doing themselves a disservice by not, and I hate to use this phrase, but like doubling down on the sequels, because the sequels came out and, you know, it was mixed to say the least. And then I think Disney sort of panicked and were like, you know, make another sort of Clone Wars spinoff with the Bad Batch. And people seem to like Boba Fett, but he's dead for now. So like, make a Boba Fett and we'll just call him the Mandalorian and we'll go from there. Now I'm, you know, downplaying those, and I love those shows, but I think that it would have served them better to say like, well, maybe the films themselves weren't perfect, but we have an opportunity to make them feel really, really good by filling in those gaps, answering those questions. You know, the fact that we still haven't gotten an answer to like where the Skywalker lightsaber was found and all these things, like there's all these gaps. And I think if those were filled in a good way, just like with the prequels and the Clone Wars and such, it would sort of retroactively, people would look at the sequels in a different light. And I think that would really help. But it's not that people would say, oh, these are perfect films now or anything, but I think that would have been the better direction to go. As much as I love things like Mandalorian and Ahsoka and all these other things, even Bad Batch, which I wasn't expecting to, but you know, the fact that their effort with the sequel trilogy was that resistance show, which, you know, as much as you want to argue like, oh, it's for kids, well, you can still make something good for kids. And I've tried watching that show 3 times now. I'm on my 4th attempt and I've only made it to episode 7. And the last, you know, episode 6 and 7 were better than 1 through 5, but 1 through 5, I mean, it's like almost unwatchable. Like the style of animation is okay, but it looks pretty cheap compared to Clone Wars. And, you know, there's like only one area, like it almost all takes place on that one outpost, which I think is just reflective of how little budget they wanted to invest in this. They don't really have any of the main characters from the sequels because they released it at a time when they didn't know how episode 9 was going to turn out. So they were hamstrung by not having a plan yet again. So these are the things that I think get in the way. But to me, these things get in the way of something that is good and that I do enjoy and that I wish could sort of live up to this potential. I think the last couple things I'll say, sort of just sort of putting a bow on episodes 8 and 9. So like after episode 8, I was kind of like, yeah, I still just absolutely love the character of Kylo Ren. Going into the movie, I was like, oh, I'm going to be disappointed no matter what, because he's the bad guy and the bad guy has to die, right? And has to die a villain. And then I was thinking like, well, you know, I don't know. Is there some way he could be redeemed? And episode 8 absolutely opened that door for me. That scene in the throne room where he and Rey team up against Snoke. I mean, I actually got kind of misty-eyed when that happened because I was like, oh my God, it's happening. All my dreams are coming true. And then at the end of that scene where they don't join and Kylo is sort of like, you know, refusing to budge his philosophy, I was like, oh God damn it. You know, they just got my hopes up for nothing. And then at the end, I really wasn't sure, you know, like when Rey literally and figuratively slams the door on him, I was like, oh yeah, is he just going to be a villain? And I think that was certainly a possibility, especially as the recent Adam Driver interview has revealed, like that was originally one of the plans. I think it was probably still in the cards, but you know, for me, this is why I'm like, thank God for J.J. Abrams. And I know it's like these days you have to either hate J.J. Abrams and love Rian Johnson or vice versa. But I think that they both contributed a lot. And again, thank goodness J.J. or whoever it was, let Ben Solo come back and be redeemed in the end. And that's why I became one of these filthy Raylos that you hear about so much. And it's not because I wanted this, you know, sort of Twilight level fan fiction romance in Star Wars. I didn't really care about that. But before episode 9, I thought to myself, the only way Kylo Ren is making it out alive is if the Raylo thing comes to fruition, is if Rey falls in love with him and wants to save him or help him save himself or however we put it. So the fact that that happened, you know, I was just so happy with that. I loved that ending sequence where he gets to actually fight as a good guy. I thought the way that Adam Driver's performance pulled it off was amazing because it actually sort of felt like a different character. Like actually felt like there had been a change of heart beyond just his slightly different hairstyle. And yeah, so I loved it. And there was also just so much in episode 9 that I really liked. I mean, Zori Bliss was barely in it, but I really loved that character. It's another character I would love to see where that goes. Like, you know, bring her into an animated show, show her history with Poe. Like, I think all of that would be great. The whole Palpatine returning thing, I think that is kind of lame only because it clearly was not planned in 7 and 8 and they didn't tease it. If they had even dropped some legitimate breadcrumbs, I have no problem with him coming back. I've read comic books long enough that I know death is only a minor obstacle in these worlds of sort of large ongoing fiction. So I didn't mind him coming back, but the way that they did it, I mean, I thought what would have been a lot better, and you almost wouldn't even have to change the script, but my hope was going to be that the Snoke that was killed in episode 8 was actually, you know, some sort of botched clone, which is kind of what they went with. But so I was hoping that there would be like a perfect Snoke somewhere that was still pulling the strings, and you know, he wouldn't have the scars, and maybe he wouldn't be all tall and lanky. Like, who knows what went wrong during the process, but So that's what I was hoping for, but it still kind of felt like that, because clearly Snoke was sort of like a little puppet that, you know, the Sith loyalists put together and, you know, pushed out into the universe, because presumably Palpatine wasn't done cooking yet or something. So, but yeah. And, you know, like growing up, like if I had to pick a favorite character, it would have been Luke Skywalker before the sequels. And so I was a little bummed at, you know, what happened to him in episode 8, but, I had actually started watching a lot of other YouTube creators talking about Luke in episode 8 in a way that, you know, it wasn't just sort of blindly defending it. And it wasn't just sort of saying like, oh, if you don't love the way Luke's portrayed in 8, it's because you're an idiot and you don't get fine cinema or something like that. But they just sort of very rationally, very logically explained how the Luke we left off in episode 6 could end up like that in episode 8, and how it would make sense. And when I coupled that logic with how he sort of, I think, comes to peace in episode 9, like I felt really good about Luke again and where he'd gone in the sequel. So I was satisfied with that as well. So yeah. So I guess I'll just reiterate once again, you know, I just thought the films, they looked amazing. The acting was great. The characters had incredible potential if they didn't always live up to it. There's still time to live up to that potential if Disney Lucasfilm wants to. And I'm hoping that the, you know, Rey film will come to fruition and help do some of that. I would absolutely love it if they would announce an animated series that would fill in all these gaps. I would totally trust Dave Filoni to do that. And yeah, I had fun with them, you know. I think that a lot of the things people can complain about for the sequels, you know, they're true. They're flawed films. All of them are flawed. But I feel like you could say the exact same thing for 1 through 6. Even Empire Strikes Back. I mean, I think that's probably the closest to perfect, but no film is perfect. And I think if the sequels hadn't come out during a time period where you have social media and an algorithm that makes it so that you can't sort of like something, you know, you have to either love it or hate it. You can't just be okay with it. And, you know, social media and the algorithm and clickbait news articles and opportunistic YouTubers and stuff, you know, they make it so that everyone has to be in one camp or another. You can't just sort of be content in the middle and say it wasn't perfect. You have to love it or hate it. Everyone who loves it is the enemy of those that hate it, vice versa. I think if the films hadn't come out in that environment, I think that also would have really helped their standing in sort of the culture. So, all right, I guess that's all my thoughts. I just rambled for 20 minutes. If I hit stop and did this again, I'd probably say something entirely different. I don't even know if I'm satisfied with what I just said, but I said it, and thanks for giving me the opportunity to say it. Love you guys. Bye.
Wow, big thank you to Nin Sage on Twitter for your take on the sequel trilogy. I really appreciate your interaction and your support. And of course, thanks to both Danny and all of you for listening to this edition of the Scarif Scuttlebutt podcast. I was kind of nervous about talking something that I really don't jive with, but it was okay, I guess. What'd you think? If you have any thoughts on anything we said in the show tonight, feel free to let us know. Give us a call and leave us a voicemail over at 773-234-8659, and we may pick it back up in a future show. Don't forget to check out the rest of the Red 5 Network at bio.link/red5. If you enjoyed this discussion, make sure to tell a friend or give us a review on your favorite podcast app. And just a reminder, we've got a few great shows on our live edition over at Scarif Live. Join us on Saturdays at 7 p.m. Central, 8 p.m. Eastern for some great interviews and discussions. Thank you again for listening. This is Ro from the Scarif Scuttlebutt Podcast, and that's the Scuttlebutt.